Jesus said, take away the stone. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for making it possible for us to assemble here today to give you glory. We ask you to preside over this meeting. Let our worship reach your throne and let the blessings that you have for us also reach those people who couldn't be here with us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Today I have titled this message, Lazarus and You. Lazarus and You. So Lazarus was a brother to Mary and Martha. And they knew Jesus. In fact, Jesus was their family friend. Jesus had been to their homes several times. And they fed him. In fact, they were buddies, so to speak. And Lazarus died. Jesus was somewhere around the country. And when Lazarus died, the sister sent a messenger to Jesus to come over. And what did Jesus do? He stayed for 2 more days. You can imagine somebody you know so much, you are so friendly of. As a family friend, we need his help. And he's taking time. I mean, you can see the frustration that these sisters were feeling. So they sent a messenger, and the messenger responded to the sisters that Jesus is taking time coming to see Lazarus. So you can see they were really, really frustrated. And so when Jesus decided to go and see Lazarus, he told his disciples, let's go to Bethany. And his disciples were even more afraid of that place because the people in that area wanted to kill him. So the disciples said, why are you going back to Judea? That's the place that these people wanted to kill you. Why do you want to go back? But Jesus said, let's go. Today's reading from John 11 tells us a story that we all can learn something from. Let's take them verse by verse. Verse 38. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Then he said, take away the stone. Take away the stone. So sometimes when we read the Bible, we just gloss over. We don't really reflect what it's actually telling us. So take away the stone. What do we learn here? What lesson do we get here? The stone was one thing that stood between Jesus and Lazarus. The stone was one thing that was standing between Jesus and Lazarus. And that was what Jesus wanted removed. Jesus is God. And he could say, he could see over the stone. He could say, Lazarus, come out without removing the stone. But what did Jesus do? He commanded the stone to be removed. So what is the lesson here for us? I want each one of us here to answer us to ourselves. In fact, you know yourself more than any other human being. Are there some things in your life that need to be removed away right now in order to experience the full glory of God? Ask yourself. You have something specific in your life that should be removed right now to experience the full glory of God. We know that we are all Christians. In fact, Lazarus was a Christian. He belonged to a family who believed in Christ. His sister was Martha and Mary. So you could see that he was still a Christian when he died. But there was a stone that was blocking between him and Jesus Christ. And Jesus was saying, remove that stone. So now we as Christians, each one of us has something that is really blocking us to experience the full glory of God. I'm not saying we are not experiencing the glory of God. Here, the qualifying word is full. To get a full glory of God. So we have to remember that. What is specific thing that is hindering us? Is it telling lies? Is it dishonesty? Is it envy? Is it pride? In fact, that one, a lot of people are so proud of themselves, they can't go that without. Is it disobedience? Is it lack of faith? Is it women or men? I know most men, the problem is about women. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
So there are so many things that are really blocking us in seeing or experiencing the full glory of God. It's an obstacle of faith that is hindering us in seeing the full glory. In fact, it says proclaim that we can do all things. Say what? We can do all things, but there is a condition. How can we do all things? There's a condition. Before you can do all things, there are a lot of things we have to remove before we can do that all things. So when we sometimes read the Bible, we have to sit down and think about it. In fact, personally, I like taking one verse in the Bible, talk about it, and think, sit down and think about the verse, what the verse is telling you, how you can reflect it in your life. The fact that we cannot do things he did means that it's a stone that has to be removed. Perhaps we are doing things that are not enough. It's not that we are not trying, we are trying, but maybe it's not enough. This morning, I want to challenge everyone to remove the stones that may be standing in the way of your getting close to Jesus Christ, as close as possible. Again, in verse 39. Let's see verse 39. Martha says, but Lord, that the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there for 4 days. They buried him for 4 days. Before Jesus Christ got to that place, Lazarus had been there for 4 days. So you can see the smell. And here, what's the lesson we learn from here too? There may be people who are quite close to you and they object, you have so many strong opinions. They object anything that you do. They try to tell you that you can't do this, you can't do that. And maybe they are talking from good faith. I mean, no, they are very concerned about you. They are talking about good faith. And they will give you all kinds of advice. Here you can see Martha giving advice to Jesus. That Jesus, my brother has been dead for 4 days, so I don't think it's going to work. We asked you to come earlier, but you didn't. So I think it's too late. That's what Martha seems to convey. Her faith was somehow shattered at that point. Your relatives may say you will not make it and cannot become a devout Christian because you've been living a carefree life, or you are so over the top that they don't believe you that you can do certain things. Maybe one day you get up and say, hey, I want to go and preach in front of Ontario Mall, and your wife might say, oh, are you joking? Are you crazy? That's not possible. I didn't see you do that. And you can't even pray. So how can you go there and preach? It's one of those situations. Here, you can see Martha was really struggling with her faith. The question here comes, do you struggle with your faith when the time is tough, when things are not going well? Do we struggle with our faith? See, these are questions that each and every one of us has to answer. Do we struggle? And if we do, what are we doing about it? What are we doing about it? All these things that we see, that is, we see in the Bible, they are all teachings for us that we have to look into carefully. For God, nothing is too late. Always remember, for God, nothing is too late. Verse 40. Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" See, here you see Christ is trying to remind the people. He's trying to remind his own people what he told them about. "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" And I guess all the adults here know how much they expect their paycheck to be at the end of the month, because we all know how much we earn an hour. We don't need to be reminded of that kind of information. But we always have to be reminded about the power of God. As human beings, there are certain things we put emphasis on so much, we forget about the heavenly things, that the capability of God, the capability of Jesus Christ, the capability of the Holy Spirit, we forget about it. Here you can see Jesus is reminding the people of the salvation and God's glory. He's trying to remind Martha and her family, or Mary and her family, of the authority of God. Because they forgot. They forgot. They forgot that Christ or God can do everything. See, this tells us as Christians where we put our priorities. Where things we remember most, things which are very important to us, our finances, our checking accounts. We know all those details. In fact, there was once a guy who would challenge any penny that his paycheck was short of. You know, sometimes, you know, you look at the payslip and you see that, hey, there is a shortcoming here. They shortchange him somehow. Sometimes it's pennies, two or three pennies. And this guy will go over to the HR, the human resource office, to challenge the people over there. Every penny that he earns, he wants to get them in his pocket. He knows exactly every detail. So you can see how and where he puts his priority. But if you ask him, "Tell me, can you recite John 3:16? That is like going to the moon. It's so complex, so advanced. You see, so we try to put our priorities in areas that we feel are very important to us. And we have to stop doing that. It's not bad to know that, but at the same time, we have to also satisfy what God wants us to do. In fact, we have to do that first. Are you the kind of person who have to be reminded about the kingdom? A Christian who has to be reminded of God's kingdom all the time, but has no problem remembering his checking account. Verse 43. He says, when he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice. He says, "Lazarus, come out." Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It wasn't enough for Lazarus to hear from Jesus saying, "Come out." So what did Lazarus do? He came out. He obeyed. So it's not enough to hear the voice of a preacher, of a pastor, whoever it is. But you have to obey. It's not enough just to hear, but obey. If Lazarus has not moved, has not made a point to obey Christ, I don't think he will have come alive. He will still be in the grave. So, we have to also obey. Whatever we hear, we try our best to obey with the help of the Holy Spirit. See, in our Christian life, it's sometimes very tricky, you know. Christian life, and that's why God says, you know, our righteousness is as filthy as a rag. Because that we can't, when you look at a Christian, what is expected of us, so much. But if God sees that we are doing our best, He is also merciful to lift a hand to us. Lazarus was commanded to do something that doesn't make sense. What is that thing? A dead man walking. Call out a dead man to come and walk again. People would think that was crazy at that time. And in these days, you can see that people would think, hey, this is a big deal. It's a big deal. Trying to wake up somebody who is dead. It's a big deal. What a lesson do we learn here? Do you find yourself being commanded to do something that doesn't really make sense to the people around you? For example, witnessing to others, like I said earlier on. So you go to the board and start, you know, talking about Christ. Say a brother wakes up one day and tells her wife or fiancé or whoever that he's going to preach. It's a big deal. What would she think? She say, "Oh, this guy is going crazy. Things are changing." Praying in public. You know, that things that we are so shy in doing. Maybe you go to a restaurant with your family, and then before you're about to eat, you all bow down and pray. A lot of people don't feel comfortable being there. People say when they see people in public, they don't really feel comfortable being there. But those are the things that God is commanding us to do. Don't look around what people may say about you. That's not important. What's important, what God thinks about you. So we have to get all these things together and do them each day in our lives. Brethren, whatever the commands God gives us, obey the Lord and let Him deal with the consequences that follow. Anything God wants you to do, obey and then forget about it. The aftermath. Because God will deal with that Himself. Verse 44. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with stripes of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Take off the grave clothes and let him go. Amen.
Amen.
You see, here we learn that a miracle just took place. You see that, but you can see that Lazarus was still limited. See, Lazarus was still limited. We've just seen that a miracle has just taken place, but Lazarus was still limited. Why? Why? Christ Himself has resurrected Lazarus. He's up. But he's still limited. Why? Look at Lazarus. He was limited in four areas when he raised up. He was limited in four areas. Note that he was still in his grave clothes. Even though he has been resurrected, he was still in grave clothes. For those days, they buried people or person like a mummy. They will wrap you up so many times. They will wrap you up. So you can't, you know, when you get up, you can't even move. You can, there's no way you can move well. In that circumstance, you are limited in movement. He was limited in his walk because his feet was bound by his grave clothes. Neither could he move his hands easily, nor could he speak effectively because his mouth was covered. I believe he could not even have seen well because there were some grave clothes on his face. Many of us had great experience with the Lord, but today we are limited by the things that are hindering us. What are the things hindering you today as a Christian? See, Lazarus came out, but still limited. There are things which are blocking him in doing certain things, moving, seeing, and all that. The same thing applies to us. We are saved, but what are the things hindering us in our lives? As Christians, what are the little things that we allow in our lives that hinders us to grow in the Lord? These are the things we have to be asking ourselves. So Lazarus is giving us a lesson here. This story of Lazarus, Christ even said, this, the death of Lazarus is going to actually give us the glory of God. It's going to teach us a lot of things. So what are the things hindering us today as Christians? Is it sin? Is it the worries of this world that allows us not to grow in the Lord? What are the things that we allow in our lives that are hindering our growth? Although we are saved, just as Lazarus was raised from the grave, he was alive, but he couldn't move much because of the grave clothes. Those grave clothes that we have on us are hindering us to grow in the Lord. Those are the petty things we do in our lives that are not helping us. So let's try to ponder on these things today. Let's allow the Lord to release us today from anything that is limiting us. As Christian believers, we have been raised from life that leads to eternal death, to life that leads to eternal life. We've been raised from a place that we were dead, and now we are alive. We've gone through the grave with Christ, and we've been raised to life in Christ. Yet, many Christians still walk about with grave clothes on. You don't want to be walking around with grave clothes. Many Christians are still bound in the clothes of death. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the old habits, the old lifestyle, the old person that you were before you were raised to the new life by the grace of God. So all those old things we want to get rid of. All those grave clothes that we have, we want to get rid of. So each and every one of us, we know ourselves more than anybody else. So ask yourself, tell yourself, what are my grave clothes? What is hindering me, making me a full disciple of Christ? What is actually blocking me? What is the obstacle in my life in growing in the Lord? When Lazarus was raised from the dead, he had no need of those grave clothes. When he was raised from the dead, he did not want to wear those grave clothes. It would only be a reminder of the days he spent in the tomb. Brethren, it is true for some Christians. Some of us know the reality of being raised to new life in Christ, but we still shuffling along the road wearing grave clothes. We still want to wear this old clothes, your old self, your old habits. And that would not lead us to anywhere. The place that that will lead us is a terrible place. So we should try to leave those clothes behind us. We have no business this morning waddling around the grave in grave clothes if you have been raised new in Christ. Those old habits should go away. The second lesson that we should learn from verse 4 and 5 here. See, the voice of Christ brings life to the dead Lazarus. In this, Jesus reveals his authority over death. The power which had held mankind in its terrible grip has been defeated. Death has been conquered by the word of Jesus Christ. See, Jesus, by his word, he was able to overcome death. Even before he died for us, he overcame death. He fought a fight against death. So that's the second, and I would say, most important message that we have here in verse 45. And when they saw that, in fact, at the cemetery at that time, Mary and Martha, and even Lazarus, they were very popular in Bethany. They were good people. So they knew a lot of people. They knew the apostles. They knew everybody loved them. So when they were in the cemetery, there were a lot of people at the cemetery. A lot of people. So they all saw what happened. So verse 45, the second part of verse 45 says, therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary had seen what Jesus did, and they put their faith in him. So you see the circumstance, how the whole thing happened. God chose a family which was well known that during the death, the burial of their brother, almost all the city residents came to the cemetery. That's where the glory of God was revealed. So the message was spreading like fire. Others saw what Jesus did in Lazarus' life, and they put what? Their faith in God. Are you a living witness for Jesus today? That's a lesson we have to learn. When Jesus or God has done something great for you, are you a witness for him? Or do you have still your grave clothes on and ashamed to let folks or people know that you are not a believer? Do you do that? Do you allow people to know what God has done for you? Or you are so much ashamed of yourself that you don't allow the word to spread? You don't tell the word to your people, to other people, to your family members, to your friends, co-workers, wherever they might be. Are you ashamed of doing that? The Bible tells us people went all over praying God. In fact, Lazarus became like a witness. See, you see something, it was like everywhere they went, they put Lazarus in front of the congregation, all the people. Say, hey, look at this guy. He was dead. And Jesus raised him up. So he became like a PR manager, so to speak. So the authorities were so mad because they see Jesus' popularity rising almost every minute. See? So you see how what we can do as Christians to make God people or people who are lost to know, to witness on behalf of the Lord what God has done for us. We have to try to talk to people about Christ. Brothers and sisters, John 12:11 says, the great crowd that gathered on Palm Sunday. John 12:11. The great crowd that gathered on Palm Sunday came not only because of Jesus. But they came just to see Lazarus. People came out to see Lazarus. It's not just to see Jesus Christ with the crown. No. People just came out just to see Lazarus. See, Lazarus was causing people to trust Christ. But this kind of witness is a privilege and duty of every Christian. And yes, it includes you and me. It includes you and me. Someone will ask, what are you saying? All I'm saying that you might never know whom you might lead to Christ if you open up your mouth and tell your testimony and be an effective witness for Jesus Christ. In fact, if you look at the Bible, Stephen wasn't, I would say, he wasn't a person who converted a lot of Christians. No. Through Stephen, we got Paul. It was through Stephen that we got Paul. See, when Stephen was stoned, Paul was a witness that right there, and he saw. And we all know what Saul of Tarsus, who later on became Paul, did for the work of God, who actually spread the word to the Gentile areas. So through Stephen that we had Paul. So it doesn't matter if you can talk to one person, two people, and submit that whatever you can do to witness, to spread the word of God, God will appreciate that. So, what a testimony if you only tell it. It may not be emphatic as Lazarus. In fact, your story might not be so emphatic, might not be so moving as that of Lazarus. You don't have a Lazarus story, like a big story like that. But any small way you can do to help spread the message is appreciated. God will tell you, well done, my servant. Any one of us has a story to tell, just like Lazarus. Any one of us. We were lost and now found. We were blind and now we see. We were cast down and Jesus picked us up and brought us out. I think I told this thing, whether Dr. Sasu or I was conversing with some people some time ago that I used to have some old pictures back in the 1860s about our natives, our people in Ghana. The Bassi missionary took those pictures. And when I look at those pictures, almost every home, every household had a small shrine. Every one of them. Not a single one. Every household had a shrine. We were all like lost. By the grace of God, God has opened the way for us.
Amen.
God has given us all the grace, all the love, all the mercies He's given us. So each one of us has a story. If you say you don't have a story, then you are not being truthful. So each one of us has a story to tell. Unfortunately, many Christians, for that matter, have opted to be on the witness program. We are not witnessing the way we should. We are hidden. We are living in secrecy. In fact, some of our family members even don't know that we are saved. So we have to come out. We have to come out. Dear brethren, God is telling us what we are and what we are free from our grave clothes. God is telling us today we are free and we have a purpose, and the purpose is what? To be a living witness to the Lord. In conclusion, what I will say is we should ask ourselves, what experience do we need this morning? this Lazarus experience. Do you need to remove something between you and Jesus Christ? Do you have something to be removed? Do you need to respond to a command of Christ? Do you need to be released from something that is limiting you? Do you need to reveal to others what God has done for you? Let's think about these things. These are simple questions, but they are tough. I want us to ponder over these things. Answer them in your heart. And if there's anything that is limiting you, or you don't understand, or confusing you, pray over it. We can't do all those things on our own. We need the Holy Spirit. So that's why we have to be praying. If we are limiting one way or the other, God is so merciful to give us a way out. We have to be sincere with ourselves. And when we do that, God will be happy with us. Let us allow these questions in our hearts, and then the Holy Spirit will work with us forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray.